Gordon Ewing and Peter Gordon. Gordon is the founder and executive director of Court Sense, based out of Northern New Jersey. His programs are 500 plus juniors starting at 3 years old, and tennis national and international ranked juniors. He has coached Americans Christina McHale for 6 years, starting at age of 13. Christina's highest ranking was 24 in the world last year on the Women's Tour. Gordon has also been a close friend of mine to Djokovic for many, many years. Dr. Peter Gordon is an incredible resource and inventor of sports science. Dr. Gordon invented the heart rate monitor in the early 1980s. He's now president of an exciting sports science technology called Optigate. Dr. Gordon is one of the leading experts in balance control and movement in the world. He is an advisor to AC Milan Football Club, the Ferrari Racing Team, the US Navy SEALs, and all US Olympic Training Centres, along with many other Olympic Training Centres around the world. My pleasure to welcome Gordon and Peter.
Inspiring me to put the presentation together today. They're Vic Borgagno, who couldn't make it today, and Dr. Gorman. I thank Vic for sharing his expertise on the split step, and I thank him for being a part of this presentation in one of our videos today. I would also like to thank Dr. Gorman for being here and sharing all of his expertise. I took the liberty to create and edit many different videos for this presentation in the attempt to convey our message in a timely manner. So, I'm going to start off with a couple of questions I personally did not know or do. Did you know that there are top professional tennis players who at times mistime their split set, so it's the wrong time they split? Have you ever spot-checked your player's split set timing on video, and you realize that if you did, they may be off, and if they're off, what is that consequence? Did you also know that most tennis players don't pop off their split as well on one leg as the other? So if I go, one side may be better than the other side. These are some questions that we're going to be answering today in this presentation and more. So here we are, we're going to have a little video. This is a player, or two players. It's Luca, who's 11 years old, or 9 years old, and Tara, who's 11 years old. They're students of ours. And we're going to see them hitting for about 30 seconds. Just to tell you a little bit about them, they're obviously hit the ball nicely. They work hard, and the reality is their split step is not as good as it may look. It's actually off. Their timing or their balance control is not too good either. But looking at the naked eye, it appears that they're doing quite nicely. We're going to be doing all kinds of assessments in all these videos today, which will give us insights and giving them solutions as well. So, why is balance control so important with the split step and with all movements in tennis? If our players are not truly able and agile in all directions, forward, lateral, backwards, they will get picked apart when they play at the higher levels of tennis. Balance control is the fundamental basis of all movement. The following video, conducted by Dr. Gorman, will show you the assessment we do with balance control. The first stages of assessment. We need video up.
As you stand on the flex,
I'm going to start over here,
sort of out to the side. We're going to look straight ahead. And when we stand on our left leg, as we stand on our left leg, we bring our right leg up as high as we can to a right angle. And when we feel comfortable, we close our eyes. When we did that little subjective test,
by the way, he's not talking about
Tara. Tara on her left leg, she moved in 2 seconds.
He'll be talking in a second. You talking about you.
Luke, when we put him on his left leg, he moved in 10 seconds. The coach now knows a subjective number, but we know that with training, we want to improve our balance control. The opposite of it, of training, is injury, where we diminish our balance control. So over time, both these numbers we want to see subjectively improve. And if they don't improve, we want to ask the question, why?
We did the same balance test on the opposite leg.
So to take a static test and make it dynamic, you introduce what they call an anticipatory change. In this case, we are on our right leg, we're going to anticipate going to our left leg, and then we're going to anticipate going back to our right leg, and it's called the Kortsett's two-step, where we're now marching in place and seeing the effects on the body. We will do this test, eyes closed, because we want to rely on the balance of coordination of the body, the engagement of the kinematic sequence, and the proprioceptive ability of the body to hold us in place. Let's see what happens. Go ahead. Moving your arms big, arms and legs big, arms and legs big. And now you're going to keep on going for 40 seconds with your eyes closed.
Now you guys can see where Luke is starting here, right? He's starting on the line. And then 25 seconds later, look where he is. This is his balance control. This is an issue in tennis.
Hey, stop. Don't move. Don't move.
If you want to move well.
Don't move. Here we have a little bit more tendency. Here we have more movement forward, and then a little bit of left hand turn. Okay? If the play is forward and to the left, my man is all set and ready for that
block shot.
He loves drop shots. To forward and to the left side. He loves it. He loves it. But what happens when I send one over his head and he has to come running back and go to the right side? He has to break that tendency. Or if the drop shot is forward, he's all set for forward, but the drop shot is this way. He has to break the tendency in the game by using energy that was meant to go after his competition. He has to use that energy to correct himself. So what we're going to look at today is a couple ideas on balancing the body, especially for the sports that you're able and agile, and then see the results of balancing the body and how well we can move left and right by measuring it precisely.
All right, so we're going to have Dr. Gorman now explain this optic gate system. This system really gives us a lot of information. So the first stage we just looked at was doing an assessment without the system, which we all can do. And I recommend it for any of your athletes, if you don't happen to have an optic gate system, to do these balance tests. Please.
So the first thing we do is subjective testing. The problem is, it's subjective testing. Every coach, every trainer will have their own opinion on what they just saw. So we developed a system called optic gate that's a modular system that ranges in size from 1 to 100 meters. The beauty of it is, each meter is connected left side to right side by 97 beams of light. So as the athlete moves through the system, we precisely, in real time, we do not wait for data, we act in real time. We know the speed of each leg, the acceleration of each leg, the ability to change direction, the jumping capacity. We know every fundamental component of movement. So we know strengths, we know weaknesses. By marking strengths and weaknesses, we can better compare. Better prepare the coaches and trainers to understand what type of training so that it can be effective and as efficient as possible to bring that athlete to optimal performance.
Great. Okay, we're going to play this video here. During the execution of a running gait or a series of jump tests, the contact and flight times can be measured with an accuracy of 1,000th of a second. The software measures in real time a series of crucial data for the movement analysis. So you're going to take that. Hold on a second. Why don't you just show us, Dr. Gorman?
So in real time, we have the left leg taking off on the split step and the right leg taking off. We know with acceleration that the contact of each leg gets faster over time. We see it for each leg that on the second step, the contact time actually slowed down. The second step, the contact time actually slowed down. If we draw a line from the first contact time of the right leg to now the next contact time of the right leg, this area triangle has a time. It's called the gap of inefficiency. This is the amount of time, and it can be calculated. This is the amount of time. This is the amount of extra time that your player is taking when he lands and takes off. The moments of time, that's the difference in making it to the ball. That's the difference in missing the ball. Every time you hear the word contact time, you hear break on and then flight. You want your break on to be as least time as possible.
Okay, the next video we'll show you is on the common assessments we do in the OptiGate system and an example of some of our findings. No matter how well trained the eye is, it's impossible to detect inefficiencies to a millisecond.
Coaches around the world tell me all the time, and I respect them. I can see that. I can see that movement. I can see that. And some coaches have been doing it so long that they have fabulous eyes, fabulous innate ability, and they can see. By the time a coach can see a compensation or inefficiency, the athlete has it. By the time you can see it, your athlete has it. The idea of true coaching is to see when others are blind. Our system allows us to see movements to a thousandth of a second so that injuries can be prevented and athletes can expand their potential. The idea of training is to see things before they develop and to correct them.
So here's a few videos of different ways we work in the system. March in place assessment and the OptiGate system.
So, before on the court, we did a very subjective test called March in place, and we used words like tendency. They had a tendency to move forward, they had a tendency to turn left or right, so it was a tendency of the body. What we did now is we did the exact same test but inside the OptiGate system. Here, precisely, we're measuring the timing of the left side of the body against the timing of the right side of the body. The more coordinated you are, the closer the timing will be. As you train, you'll improve your timing, you'll improve your rhythm, you'll improve your coordination. As you injure, you'll lose your coordination, you'll lose your rhythm. It's the opposite of training. So what we do is we measure the amount of time the right foot is on the ground compared to the amount of time the left foot is on the ground. Then we measure how long the right leg flies through the air compared to how long the left leg flies through the air. By doing thousands of tests around the world, we know that the human body is not a perfect machine. We do something crazy, like we did out of the war. We take away the visual ocular reflex. We take away the coordination. We take away our radar. Was our radar aiding us and helping with our coordination? Or was our radar actually giving us wrong information? In Tara's case, her radar was helping her. Because when we took it away, she went from off by 0.5 to off by 2.6%. Still well within the normal range, but a dramatic change. When you're talking small numbers, she actually changed by 5 times the amount by taking her radar away. We'll at a later date talk about proprioceptive ability. When you don't have your eyes open, when your eyes are closed, you're reading the ground with your feet. That's your proprioceptive ability. This test, a very precise, objective test, shows you fundamentally what is the balance and coordination of my child, what is the balance and coordination of my athlete. Is it getting better over time, or is it starting to wane over time? His flight time went up by 1.3%. His flight time differential, a little bit high, 9.3% and 5.4%. And he's using his ability to compensate down. Coach wants to know that. That's why court says we do a protocol to fix that. What we want is we don't want to use energy to fix this differential being off. We want to use the energy to play the game. We want to use the energy to face our opponent. We knew that closing the eyes would give a little bit of discoordination. Because when Lucas stood before, eyes open, straight as an arrow, closes his eyes,
So the question is, why do I have everybody close their eyes? You played the game of tennis, obviously, with your eyes closed. Because your eyes are looking at your opponent. Your eyes are looking at the court. Your eyes are giving you field sense. How do you read the ground? How do you move? Your feet read the ground. That's your proprioceptive ability. So we're looking that way. An athlete who plays with his head down looking at his feet plays slow, needs to pick the part. So we have to know the proprioceptive ability of our athletes so we can play the game efficiently. That's why we close the eyes of our athlete so we can see that the demand that's placed in the body by removing the visual ocular reflex is compensated for to a proprioceptive sense.
Coordination,
that little shake affects performance, and that little shake is what we remove before we allow further training.
So here the jerk protocol
is contact time on Luker. He's 13.1% quicker on his right leg to execute the power than he is on his left leg. 13% quicker to pull the trigger on a gun that's 27% bigger. Wow, Luca has a great right side. Does it? Wow, you have to go to the third dimension. Power, pull the trigger. What's the next thing you have to do to win the competition? You have to aim. You balance control. The name of the test is jump in place, looking straight ahead five times. Luca needed an area of 100 square inches to jump in place off his right leg. Luca only needed 71 square inches to jump in place off his left leg. So even though he has more power, and even though he can pull the trigger quicker, his aim is off by 40%. What we want to see, as we do the court sets, balance, and stability drill, what we want to see, does the shaded area over time get smaller? As the power gets bigger, as the contact time gets quicker, that's the art of movement, not just power of law.
Acceleration with a split step assessment in the OptiGate system.
What are we finding out? We're finding out there's acceleratory differences between the two motors. Power, execution power, balance control. All of these comprise the idea of contact and flight. Contact and flight. The beauty of Luca was that on the stopwatch he was the fastest child in this group. But when you break him down to step-by-step analysis, we know that over time acceleration starts to zero out when you reach constant velocity. So with Luca on his right leg, he has the acceleratory ability of this much. We would expect that the next leg is slower. What happens? When Luca goes from his left to his right, he actually increases it. He increases his acceleration. We go back to the right leg, and it's down again. Then we come back to the left leg, it's up. So what happens? If I play Luca right to left, I'm probably going to beat him. Even though he's the fastest on the stopwatch, linear. When I ask him to change direction, or I look precisely at his acceleratory ability, I notice that I have a deficit in my athlete. Very good, left to right. Deficit, right to left.
That's big. All right, so the following video are some ways that we do some enhancement work. So you can only imagine if I do split, and I go quite quickly this way, but I go here and I shake a little bit, and I'm going, well, that's what Dr. Gorman's talking about. We're going to be slow. So how do we get better at this? Here's a video that shows some of the ways that we do it over a court sense, and there's no reason everybody else can't do
it. Once you are able to go 15-15 with your eyes closed, you graduate to a foam pad. So we put a foam pad down on the floor. We take an athlete, Luca, hop up over here. And on the first test, Luca will stand on his left leg.
I just want to pause for 1 second. He wasn't ready for the foam pad, but we did it for this video. We had it on his left leg, because that was his better leg, to see if he can balance on the foam pad. We're going to see that it was quite difficult. But here we go.
But eyes open, and we'll see how well he does. So bring your right leg up, hold your arms out to the side. One, two, three, done. It's a little bit different. What are we affecting here? We're affecting Luca's proprioceptive ability. Once Luca trains himself and he can stay with his eyes open on the fall pad, he'll then increase the demand of the test by doing the same test with his eyes closed. Now, let's see exactly who we are. Let's measure it. Let's improve. Here we go.
Let's do it. I'm going to pause it here for a second as well. This happens to be one of my favorite tests. Because if you think about it, when you split step, you're popping. So he's going back and forth. And we're going to see right now he's at 12%. His contact time is off. He gets up to around 30% off. And you're going to see what Dr. Berman says in a moment. And all of a sudden he gets better. And his compensation is better.
He's there as well. Watching over here.
He's at 30% now.
Skill so that before he lands on the court, he knows the direction and Thus he can turn his hips, get his feet oriented, and land on the what we call the offside foot. And we'll talk in a moment about some of the advantages of doing it. Let's appreciate the investment.
This is where it gets hairy. Cat and mouse.
That force
power. Now, what they were going to see when we looked at the video, when you did the hitting without this, without going through this, is sometimes you do little jumps like this. Imagine that power versus a little higher. Right? So we're going to work on the split step with a light that's going to get you better.
Just make sure you know when the split step is. It's definitely going to be the split hop. You're not going to be going any direction yet. I just want to make sure you get the idea of when to actually do the jump for the split step.
Okay, so here we go.
This light, those eight lights that go down, and they got a jump at the right time.
It's going up.
So it's an anticipatory light.
Try it again. Good. Again.
And then we have a direction of the light going.
Okay, here we go.
At the top of the hop.
Good.
And it's going to be an app that this guy right here will be putting out in about 2 or 3 weeks. I think it's quite helpful. And then lastly, this is the last video. These are examples of how we use this light. Many uses of this split-step light. Shadowing with the light, hand feeding the light, ball machine with the light. Logical progressions make the learning process more fun and productive. Thank you everybody for listening.